point. Here's a little bit deeper, which is a static analyzer.
Can you speak up a little bit?
I will speak up a little bit.
There we go.
So why are we in this room today? It's because programming is hard. It's pretty hard, and it's when you program and you want to write bugs as much as possible, you need to think of all the possible cases. In the worst case, you need to keep track in your head of the possible values that this function can be called with, or that can flow through your program from the user. If something can be known in your program, it will be known someday for someone, and your program will crash. And if you ship bugs to your users, then you won't be happy. You sometimes need to take active steps to clear the bugs, for instance, to break their app or services. So what do we do to combat that in engineering? Well, we try to do best code. Yes. So we develop coding practices. We test responsibilities. We try to architecture the code in a way that minimizes bugs of the boundaries. We add more tests. And then you can also speak a language that has more or less more pure hookups or pitfalls. Does your language have null values? Allow objects to be null, or you should play Java and you manipulate files, for instance, you should destroy resources so that you don't forget about the files. On your language, you can have a more or less rich type system, which will also prevent a range of issues. Although you can always choose your language, as tons of have on there, sometime in your life. Or you have to pick a particular language to please a particular vendor. So in this talk, I will talk about static analysis. And it's just one additional way to give signal to developers that the code is good to go and doesn't have too many bugs. So in contrast to testing, static analysis, the way I will present, attempts to check all program paths and all values at the same time and ensure that the program works in any case. And you can also think of it sometimes as palliative from key language features. For instance, if your language, for some reason, decided that all objects could be null and there's no way to know except to test at runtime, then static analysis could be a way to make sure that things are not at the point where you're different. So, Infer is such a static analyzer. Written in Camel. It analyzes Java and C family of language, C, Objective C, and we added C++ support last year. We're still working on that actively. And the main characteristics are it's interprocedural, so it will track flow of values from functions to functions and across translation units to find inconsistency in the code. So something can be known deep inside a function call and you read deep inside another function call. And the other characteristic I want to stress is that it's incremental. So it's very fast at analyzing code changes, and that's very important for those who use it. So, it works on GitHub. It has a pleasing amount of stars. This is from back when we were so people at the time seem to like it. Since then, we've opened collaborations with other companies, so it is not used only at Facebook. Which is Spotify, and Uber, and more and more. If you want to use Infer, you can visit the website, and you have two options. You can get started on your code base, or you can even try it on your browser if you want to quickly test some functionality. This is for an old version of Infer, but it's a good idea of what you can do for Java. So, that's it for the introduction, I will start with a quick demo. So this is a tiny project. It's a bunch of C files and the make file. Make it compiles the file, and if I want to run infer on this, first make in. Because infer will just we use you pass the build command that you use for your project to infer, and it will hijack the compiler and the compilation tools and the compilation the build system. To figure out what it needs to build, and then you will hijack the compiler calls to read the source file itself and analyze them. So here we see that it's detected by make mode. This is make talking, then it's compiling the file. And then once these are captured, then the analysis starts, and here we find three issues. One is not the reference, so it's not here, so they point above, which I got here, is the reference here, and put it out. Also, it should be a leaky memory. And so this one we can understand straight away. We declare a null pointer, and we dereference it. And so we can go for this. So we can explore the report using another tool, actually, using Oracle.
Hey, Jules, will you try to keep the terminal up at the top? So you can see it.
We try. it displays a big dress, which you can read through. It's informative, but let's do it in Emacs instead. So here it repeats the bug, but then we see the actual symbolic trace. So these are the steps of symbolic execution that we follow to detect an issue. So it says, I entered in this other procedure, and if you go inside, it's in another file, and it's analyzed also that made a connection between the two. And so you call this procedure, which calls map, this suspicious bit of command code, and then here you get to here, and the trace says condition is false. So P not equal to null is false. So at this point, we know P is equal to null, and we return P. We get out the function, and now what that means is that Bob is not here. And then we get into get stage, which is again another file, and what we see is this procedure just the reference is a pointer. So there you go, you have another reference. So what we're going to do to fix this is assume that malloc doesn't fail. And then we're going to rerun infer, and if I rerun make here, what you expect is that only the file that I changed will be compiled. So you can tell infer that, you can tell infer exactly that it has to capture some reactive change, it has to react to a change that I'm doing a full analysis, so it will not discover what it captured before and what it analyzed before. It will just capture whatever is new, so it just person.c, and reanalyze just that file. And then the files that depend on it. So here, in particular, it's reanalyzed pub.c because it depends on person.c. And so now you see that there is one fewer bug listed here because it reanalyzed all the things that depend on our change. So then the memory leak is should be easy to fix. We don't need to look at trace for that. So if we get a new object pub and we get some field pub, but again, is still alive, and we haven't freed it. So what we need is we need to remember the age of Bob somewhere. I rerun again. I only get my this issue. I don't believe the real issues are here. Okay, so this is a quick glimpse of what Infer can do. It was very simple my project, but you can very practice runs on very large projects, and this supports an array of build systems. And the kind of things like Bitfinds, we go over quickly there on the website. There's more explanation there. But really, for C, C++, there's another front memory leaks and resource leaks. So if you open a file and you forget to close by descriptor or things like this. So very, very akin to memories. For C++, it doesn't quite do the rebound checks yet. That's a hard problem in static analysis, so we haven't quite come up with something happy with it. But what it can check is, which is a pattern that happens sometimes, is the vector is actually empty and you try to access an element. And so this is easier to check. It also detects static initialization on the Casco, which should be included. Very different, you know it, and I don't know what to name. And things. We do Objective-C because we run on for iOS. So there, the only thing I'll mention is that we invert detects retain cycles, which are cycles in the memory that defeat the simple counting garbage collector bubble. So you learn on that. And so this is an example of things that static analysis can help with. If your language has some issues with this. And for Java, there's a GC, so we don't care about memory leaks, but we still have another reference and resource leaks. There's a thing analysis, referring to that. There's, that's an interesting recurrence game for some engineers testers to do that at Facebook. So this is something where you can annotate some methods as performance critical in your code, for instance, things that run on the UI thread in a web app. And you can annotate other methods as expensive. And then Infer will check for you that there's never a call chain from a performance critical method to an expensive one. And others, you can see the website. We have also some Android-specific checks, like context leaks and pragmatically, thank you. So I mentioned that this was just a toy project. For instance, we run on DuckDuckGo, which is the app for the DuckDuckGo browser, search engine, sorry. So here's an example bug. So the report by Info was, there's a resource you acquired at line 2 and it's never released at some other line. So what I mean in the code here is, we annotated the resource here by doing this DB query. And here there's an if branch. And in that if branch you can return for the function before you put close. And so here you leak the cursor. So that's that. Another example, so here what do we have? It says that this feed object here from this nested method call can be held, and then it's the reference. Let's see, it goes into the function, which initializes things to mount. Then it does a DB query, there's an if. At this point, the cursor can be empty, and so we don't ever enter that branch, and we get the finally, we close it, and we return out, which we never changed from the beginning, so it's still none. So here, the end of the story is feedback is none at this point, and we go inside this other function, and Infer, when it analyzed it, so that one of the things it does is the references it forms. So here you got an empty. Okay, that's it for art. So I will say a little bit about how Infer works generally. Not going into the details of symbolic execution algorithm or anything, just the various phases of the Infer runs. So that's helpful to understand how to use anything. And then I will tell you the story of how we use it at Facebook. So the architecture of Infer is like this. So this is your program. It's a bunch of source files and the build system that knows how to compile them. And these are the things import support can do. And so the first thing is it goes through the front end, which knows how to drive the build system to get to the source files. And it translates the source files from all these languages into a common, very simple intermediate language called SIL, which is basically just go-dos and loads for an assignment. And then once it's captured all the bytes in your project, it starts the analysis. And so for each procedure that it found in the source file, it will produce summaries. And if at some point it to produce summaries, it will attempt to prove that the procedure has no bugs. At some point it will not manage to prove that, and at that point it will decide whether to report that as a bug or not. So let's dig into the first step, capture. So here's a simple Java class. Let's look at this method, compute something. So it tests the flag pass as argument, it returns either null or something. And the front end, we translate this method as a simple control flow graph. So here, you see you cannot read this, but where we can see is you can see the two if branches, and these are the instructions in each branch, so you're just signing a string, and then at the end both branches join to the exit node. So that's it for capture. It does that for all the source files, and then we translate each procedure as something like this, and then the analysis runs on those small CFGs, or big CFGs, no matter. And what it attempts to do is it attempts to understand, to find specifications for them. So what do I mean by that? So for instance, for this method, it will discover that if the parameter is false, then it will return something. And if it's true, it returns null. And so the state before the procedure is called a precondition, and the state afterwards is called a postcondition. And together they form a specification of the function. So if you start with this precondition and you return the function, then you will start at the condition. And so for this function, there are two specs because of this junk. And then if we look at the other method, it calls the first one, stores the result into S, then tries to compute the best of them. And infer is not enough to see that this function depends on the other ones. Or if it hasn't already, when analyzing this method, you will realize that you need to first compute specs for the other one. So at that point in the method, you will have these two specs for the callee. And we call compute something of true. So if we look which specs make sense for that. And only this one makes sense. So when you call that function with true, you know that it returns null. So at this point, you know that S is null, and the next line is then used because you observe referencing. Okay. That's it for how infer works. In its main mode of operation, I want to briefly talk about two other modes of operations. One is eradicate. So in Java, object can be null. If you wish it wasn't so, you can use eradicates. So with eradicate, you can annotate objects that can actually be null with add null, and everything else will be assumed to never be null. And what eradicate does is it will check that the whole code base is consistently annotated in that fashion. And what that means is, and whenever you dereference something that was marked null, then you better check from null before, and otherwise eradicate will yell at you as well. And if you do your code base like this, in theory you should have no runtime, no pointer exceptions. So it's more like a type system top of Java, rather than the main mode of infer, which tries to really track values. Another mode is for the client side of infer. We have what we call linters, which are simpler check, which are just syntactic, and walking over the AC and looking at the nodes. And What's interesting is you can write your own checkers easily. Either inside infer, you can add them in infer if you know to write camel, or you can even use the simple DSL we have. And I wanted to show what one of these checkers can look like. So this is a checker cracking a PC. A property with a point type should not be declared assigned, whatever that means. And so the checker for that is just this struct that says when to report, what message to report, and the checker triggers, and the fix suggests the point type. And so when to report is easily expressible here. It's if this is a assigned property, then if it's of pointer type, and if I'm inside an Objective-C property vehicle, then I should report. So, and you can write quite a range of checkers using this language. Okay, so now you've got this, deploy info for the project. I'm very happy to hear that, thank you. So how does it work? So at Facebook, when the team arrived, they wanted to analyze the mobile apps. So now we're looking at millions of lines of code on Objective-C. And so there was a question of how to do that, how to surface bugs to developers. Because you have this tool, you can output a list of bugs, and you have people working on the case. So the first thing they tried is just an infer, get the bug list, and try to be smart about assigning bugs to the right person. Some people in the room know about that. So that didn't work so well. It turns out anything a couple weeks old is already history for a developer, so completely switch to a different task by then. And if it hasn't caused a crashing problem, then it's too good anyway. And for bugs reported by static analyzers, it's very hard to know if there are actual bugs or not, but the analyzer only analyzes functions locally, and it doesn't try to start from entry points or things like this. And so the metric here is really seeing the bug, does the developer think it's worrying enough that he fix it? So instead, what we found out is we have to integrate infer inside the development model of developers. So when the code is fresh in their mind, and best time to do that is at diff review time. So, we're submitting code to review, and infer will comment on the code just like the rest of the CI and other reviewers. So developer sends a diff, and so this is more or less set up at Facebook. So we use Packager as our code system. It's also open source. So the diff goes into the CI, into the Fabricator. The CI runs a test, and one of the things it runs is infer. Meanwhile, the code reviewers give their opinion on the code, and infer will try to find issues with it. So for instance, let's say it's on the back, then what the developer will see is something like this, just message like one of the reviewers' message or the same message saying, oh hey, I think this can be another reference. And then at some point everyone happy and infer is happy as well. And the diff goes to work. So in a bit more detail on the infer side of what happened here, what happens is under the hood, when we get a diff, we run infer on the top revision, the one with the diff, with the changes of the developer. And we run it also on the version, the base revision of that, so before the change. And then we compute only the new bugs, the one introduced by the diff, presumably introduced by the diff, and we report those. So we don't report all bugs, because as we saw, developers are not really interested in fixing those. And we report only new bugs, and this way this gives I signal to the developer that they're responsible for these difficulties, or at least find a good story as to why it's not an issue. So for now, these steps are infer another release for helping the developer to run the product and do these things. Again, because this, the business logic we have is in Facebook CI, not in infer itself, but we're this. These days, we're working on bringing that logic into infer itself so that more people can benefit from this work. So, yeah, that's it. So, every month, infer runs on thousands of modifications on those mobile pages. And it reports hundreds of times per month, and that is fixed by developers. And what I was talking about before, what we measure is the rate at which people fix bugs. So we want that to be very high, otherwise people will start ignoring the tool and then it's game over because most people are trying to ignore the tool, it's better to come back. So approximately 70% of the warnings that we heard gives out. And that's it. Thank you for your attention. Question is, does it work for recursive code? So you mean two recursive functions in the code? So, in theory, yes. So, infer used to... So, in theory, what you do in the theory in infer is, when you have mutually recursive functions, you start by analyzing any one of them, and you analyze the others based on the result of that, and then you go around the loop some amount of time, and you convert them. And then at some theoretical point in the future, the specs will stop changing. In infer, in practice, we go around the loop twice. And I think that was a futuristic. I think now we don't go around the loop. We go around the loop only once. We start somewhere, we give it an empty spec, and then we go around. Because in practice, people don't write that many recursive functions, so we don't have to. But if someone wants it. I mean, the theory supports it and the tool supports it. It's just a matter of if somebody cares enough that they can add to it. Yes?
Would you want to resolve that? Go back. When you have dynamic windows, when you have text groups, your tool is an advantage to do that, you didn't know, or just training?
So the question is, how do you control flow graphs, given that there are external functions, loops,
function pointers,
and dynamic dispatch and the like. So there are several issues in what you mentioned that all need to be tackled. And the answer, so the CMG itself is just a mirror representation of the EST, so it's nothing particularly in there. For instance, it's a dynamic dispatch. So when you go to a function, a method call, and you have to do method resolution, and at that point, infer will track the precise type of the object you need, and you use that type to figure out which method. And what that means, what dynamic dispatch, the biggest hurdle we have to overcome was that the call graph is now dynamic. You can first start by computing your call graph of your whole project and start analyzing function in order, starting from the queries going to the callers, because you don't know which one is calling which other one. And so the way we cope with that in infer is an on-demand analysis. So when we get to a call site, it could be that we haven't analyzed that function yet because it's dynamic dispatch, and we didn't realize that this was a call E. And so at that point, infer knows how to, somebody's doing, go analyze another function and come back to one system. But these are all very good, very tricky issues, and we solve some of them in dynamic dispatch, and we do a sort of thing, function pointers. So what was your list again? So multi-threading assumes everything is sequential for now. We are starting to develop a concurrency analysis in Java.
Alright, we have calls to external functions.
So calls to external functions, that's an interesting one. So we have two approaches here. One is for libraries that are used often and for which it matters. We have models inside Inter, so it knows what's a hash map, what it does, a bunch of things like this. So you can always add models. And in general, but the base thing it does is if it finds a function that it doesn't know anything about, then what it will do is what we call inject mode. We assume that function does the best possible thing for the rest of the program. So if it returns an object and you let it reference it, then oh yeah, it was probably allocated by the function. And doing that, we found we enabled us to analyze a lot more code than when we used to be more pessimistic. Yes?
So you mentioned that 30% of the data output is because of possibility, or
so the question is that the 30% of issues that are not fixed by the developers. So as I said, it's impossible to make this thing a false positive. It's been weeks and one bug to figure out if you can produce it. So we don't try to measure that.
And you use the developer, like you say, like, okay.
So what we do is, in our team, we have someone look at the bugs that have been ignored by developers in several iterations of their dev. And we go look at those, and we have a discussion with developers, say, oh, maybe then you fix that, it's like a bug to me, or, oh, sorry, this is clearly a false positive, we try to improve Inter for that case. So we improve the tool continuously based on that.
For C++, which compilers are supported here?
So the question is which compilers are supported for C and C++, so the answer is depending.
So you read just the intermediate language for both C and Java?
So
do the analysis not on top of the source code, but the intermediate language?
So to elaborate, so we do the analysis Clang on top of the Clang AST. So we start from AST. For Java, we start from bytecode.
That means on top of the Scala.
The question is, can we do Scala? Yeah, in theory we can, but the thing is we have, there's no particular difficulty there, but we don't have a mode where we can just give bytecode inference and we'll analyze it. You have to give the source code along your block. But if somebody wants to analyze that, then the output. Yes?
How do you compare with OOD and static analyzer? Because there is one class of analyzer.
Yes, so the question is how does it compare with Clang static analyzer? So there are a bunch of static analyzers in the wild, and what we found out when trying to compare them is that they all report pretty much different sets of bugs. So the best strategy here is run them all.
Because it's kind of obvious question, because you can find why people you plug anyway, they would find it such a good idea. And it's faster, more stable.
So the question is, actually answer the question. I don't have a very good answer to that. I can put technical differences between the tools. For instance, Clang static analyzer is limited to analyzing a single translation unit, whereas Infer works across translation units. In general, in Infer tries to find sort of debugs, it's pretty interprocedural, so it will find bugs sometimes across local chains, and I haven't seen that very much time. And it's also not looking necessarily to yes, please.
How this works in integration and how to learn it class?
Pardon?
This supports integration and, for example, acquire it classes.
I'm sorry.
How to learn it option that Spring integration.
Spring integration in Java?
Acquire it in Java.
JavaScript. I know what that is.
That's your answer. There was another.
Yeah, we can talk offline.
Here?
Yeah. We can teach you about JavaScript. Have we considered rendering the reports in each yeah, that would be great.
Thank you.
Do you plan to put info on the popular CI tools like Jenkins? Or?
So do we plan to put info on popular CI tools like Jenkins? So I don't see any difficulties with that. Or I don't think we want to do that ourselves because we don't use it, so it doesn't make much sense. But what we're doing, as I said, is we're trying to put most of the logic you would need to do that inside infer, like, so that you could say infer diff analysis of this and that, and then it will automatically just compute, do what I said, organizing the top revision, the base revision, and the change file. And then the reports from infer are simple JSON objects, so hopefully someone will write some interface for that.
And
I would just rephrase the question for you. Before Java Enterprise, annotations, dependency injection, and stuff like that.
Ah, right, sorry. Yes, so dependency, I think we all that is resolved before we run, because it's not very good. The other question was about Java. Yes?
Do you have any IDEs for
Do we have any IDEs for it? Not at the moment. It would be nice to have. Very good Emacs support. It's not really support. It's just the YARs are formatted in a way that editors like Emacs response, but in that there's nothing to in TJ to run for an exchange.
Another question. Infer is written.
Infer is written for Camel.
You said that you run on diff, just on diffs. Does it imply that you need some data storage for storing some state or previous binary?
Right, so the question is, you mentioned that we run on diff, so does it imply that we make some external storage of issues? So, not really. So, no, because what we do is we really run in for on the diff and on the base revision, so we run it twice for every diff. So that we can do comparison and so forth. So, but the longer story is we're most of our projects use Buck, and we use Buck cache to cache the results of the analysis. So it's very often the case that some parts of the analysis results are already in the cache, and we don't run them. Yes?
If I recall correctly, I saw one slide where the output from infer was pushed to a source code management system or review system. Was that correct? Or do you support integration with, for instance, Bitbucket or GitHub, that the remarks of infer coming to the review pane?
So the question was, there was one point where I showed an infer command inside a review tool. So it's just integrative fabricator and that's not even infer talking to the fabricator API. It's just the CI reading the results from infer and then looking at fabricator. So we don't really have this sort of integration, but that's something we're hoping to build. Or build tools for people to reason into. Yes.
You showed a slide on the Java Durable. There's a lot of comments on the
commented code where I showed something, did I cheat? this guy? that might be the fix.
Thank you.
do we have tools for scripting languages? We don't have tools for scripting languages. But everyone is welcome to write their own content for their scripting language and interface with Perl. So the thing is, it's just a matter of writing a compiler from your language to read first. So what we did, we support all languages, basically, was from so if you emit the intermediate language, then you can interface whatever content.
Do you have time for other projects like Firefox or LibreOffice or something like that? How long it would take to run all that? For example, for LibreOffice, it's
so the question is
run more than a day.
Sorry?
For LibreOffice, Coverity runs more than a day. That's why
right.
We just get analyzed before.
I don't think
one.
I'm allowed to hear information about Coverity, so.
So I'm ready.
So the question is, how long does it take on big projects such as Firefox? And I will delegate.
So I'm running in Firefox, so for Joy, it takes like 1 hour. It does. And for C, it takes about 2 hours. So in a CI, it's working perfectly fine. The feedback will be good.
So the answer is on Java, it's less than 1 hour. What, in the diff analysis, can give the Facebook side, on this, we aim to report within 10 minutes. And so our P50 is probably around that. Our P95 is much worse because of the deep analysis in products, sometimes a small change can trigger. And it also depends how much is in the cache.
Yes. You said that it's actually the problem is bugs on the leaks and not figure out why. Do you look when the bug leaks and how people are using them in a way? It's more also people
question. Okay, so the question is, I mentioned that we go look at bugs that people don't fix. Do we also look at bugs that people do fix and how do they fix them? Sometimes we're very anecdotically because mostly if the bug has been fixed, then we first stop reporting at some point, so we have it. And then hopefully be much more
important. What do they there's like tests to demonstrate bug, for example. Just to
The question is, for example, they write tests to make sure the bug is gone. I don't think they do, so these are not runtime bugs. These are, that's a good question. So, one thing is, info will be running on the next diffs as well, so if you found it this time, next time, so maybe our engineers have come to rely on the business. No more questions? Okay, thank you very much.